Sharon Lechter is dedicated to sharing relevant and actionable steps to help you build a strong and sustainable financial foundation for your family. As co-author of Think and Grow Rich, 3 Feet from Gold, and Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and founder of Pay Your Family First, Sharon's messages have helped people around the globe take control of their financial lives. Please enjoy Sharon's It's Your Turn to Thrive, an audio series created just for you. In this audio, Sharon is joined by Dara Lynn Randon, a certified tax law specialist with the firm of Randon & Associates. Dara specializes in tax matters, in properly structuring and protecting her clients' estates and business matters. Sharon and Dara discuss the important topic of It's Yours, Now Protect Your Wealth.
Welcome to It's Your Turn to Thrive audio series. I'm Sharon Lechter, and I'm delighted to present this series for you because it's something that I would have loved to have had when I was a young married woman trying to find my way and make sure that I had my financial life in order. And today I'm thrilled to welcome Dara Randon, a dear friend of mine, but also a very successful estate attorney and someone who can truly add value and help you make sure that you have your documents and your life in order. Dara, welcome. Happy to have you here.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, as you said, I'm an attorney. I've always been an attorney. That's more than 30 years, and I kind of stopped counting at some point. And my practice is focused in the areas of estate planning, business, and tax. So I'm always looking at those kinds of issues for our clients.
And really today, the area of personal finance and business and tax all kind of come together, and you really need to look at the entire picture, don't you?
It's a very complicated world that we live in, and if someone ignores any piece of those topics, they're likely to have a big gap in their planning.
One of the things that really has driven me to do this series is when I look back at my own life, the value that I could have derived from this information when I was young and married would have been really a great benefit to me. I married my husband back in 1980, Michael Lechter, and I was blessed to marry two small children at the same time. Philip and Shelley were 4 and 2, and they became my children. I was their mother, and I took care of them every day, and I spent a lot of time with them alone. But yet I had no legal rights to get them medical care, to sign them up for things. So it was something that became very clear to me really fast that I should have taken some steps. And it was, I think there were 9 and 11 when I finally said to Mike, we really need to make sure that I can get them the kind of care that they need. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, one of the things that you said, and you said a mouthful in your relating of your personal experience, is that these are legal documents. And so I absolutely have to say that with all of these documents, people need to use trained attorneys for advice and preparation of those documents, because we don't know what we don't know, and we don't have a good way of determining that there's something out there that we really don't know about. And so I often find that self-help by people leads to documentation or situations that actually hurt them rather than do the things that they want. So, for example, in your situation, you needed to have a power of attorney from Michael, and a power of attorney would have enabled you to make at least short-term medical decisions for his children, to enroll them in school, and to handle a number of things for them. And many states have specific provisions for that kind of child care power of attorney.
And it's very important today with the number of blended families that we have. My case is not unusual. There are many people out there that love and cherish their children but may not have those legal rights without that kind of legal power of attorney.
Exactly. And it works very well for grandparents who take the grandchildren for summer vacation. It works well for parents leaving their children with a sitter if they're out of town. It works well for all sorts of situations like that. And you first have to know that it is a document that exists, and then that it will open the world for the caregiver.
And then as my life progressed, my husband and I had our own child, so we had a third child. And it was at that point in time when we again sat down with the estate attorney and we said, you know, we need to make sure our will is in order and that we've taken care of this. And what I learned, which I did not know at the time, was I actually had to expressly in writing say that I wanted all three children treated equally on my behalf.
Definitely. The will is where you express your own personal wishes, your values, those things that you value. And unless you put it in a legal document that is appropriately written and signed or executed before witnesses and that kind of thing, whatever state law requires for each locale, then you can't be sure that your personal values are going to be carried out, and they may be contrary to what the law is for everyone else or the default law. So for you to personally express what you need your own will and you need to be thinking about it. So I think that that's a really excellent example that you used. You wanted all three offspring, even those that weren't your natural children, to share equally. And that's not what the law provides if you did not have a will, but your will can override the law.
And you made the comment about individual state laws. So many people move quite often now, and it's really important that different states have different rules as it relates to a will. So give a little bit of advice, if you don't mind, about if you truly want a will, it's best to have it in writing and to have it secured by an attorney and make sure that it's been notarized and held in safe spaces. And when you appoint an executor of your will, sometimes states require that executor be in that state. So give us a little bit of your 30-second advice for when you have a new client and they say, I don't understand the will.
Well, first of all, there is no such thing as an oral will, so it has to be in writing. I cannot make that point clearer. And if you talk with someone and say, here are all the things that I want, and you don't get to the point of signing, then your will is of no value, and state law, whatever that state law is, will control. In the United States, through the U.S. Constitution, we have the full faith and credit clause. And now I'm really talking like a lawyer. And the full faith and credit clause says that each state will respect the laws of every other state. So if you live on the East Coast and you get a will and then you are transferred to the Midwest, for example, your will still will be valid in your new home. You may, however, want to at least get it reviewed by a local attorney. Not only should your documents be reviewed every so often because laws change and your life changes, but also just to be sure that there aren't some peculiarities of the local law that you might wish to take advantage of. So it's not that your East Coast will would not be effective in the Midwest. It's just that there may be Midwestern laws that could be more effective for you than the East Coast laws.
And I think in some states, you can actually handwrite your will and it's accepted. I know in Arizona, that's the case. And I was kind of surprised to hear that. Is that true?
Yes. Holographic wills, meaning that you have handwritten them, are accepted in many states, but there have to be state statutes that say that. So you can't just assume. But it's a good bet that a holographic will would be given legal significance. The important thing in doing a holographic will is that there cannot be anything else on the piece of paper other than your handwriting of your will. And this is, though, where it comes into play that you don't know what you don't know. So you have to be sure that when you write out your will, you cover all the important pieces. And again, not everyone knows what those might be. I will say, though, that when I've had clients call me up and say, I'm leaving on a trip tomorrow, what can I do? I will help dictate to them a holographic will so that I'm sure that they put in all the nuts and bolts that need to be there.
My husband and I have actually done that too. When we left for a 5-week trip, we sat down in handwritten form because we hadn't really updated our will in a while. So that's a very good bit of advice. Now, when we talk about a will, talk about the consequences of if you should pass and your significant other, your spouse, passes as well, and you have children in a state, and yet no one else in your family is in that state. What happens? What's the process?
Many states these days are very clear that they don't require your executor or guardian of children or trustees of trust to be residents of your same state. But there are still some states with, shall we say, holdover laws that maybe don't recognize how mobile our society is, that would require an executor to be a resident of a particular state before being able to act. I haven't run into that very much, and it's usually a fairly easy process to get a court to appoint an ancillary fiduciary for a particular state. All of this is to say, though, that with proper planning, none of these issues will ever come up. And I need to make that point over and over again. So you, before your trip, wrote out your holographic will. Well, 4 weeks before that 5-week trip, if you'd thought about it, you probably could have gotten in to see your lawyer and had a quick amendment done, and then you wouldn't have been at the last minute doing things. So last minute's better than nothing, but a little bit of advanced planning is always the better course.
Well, and that planning can take a half an hour to an hour versus having months of legal issues because you haven't put a will in place.
Oh, I cannot tell you how badly it can be. Truly, having no will leaves a mess, and the messes come in all different shapes and sizes, but I'll tell you, it costs a lot of money to clean up messes, and relatively speaking, it doesn't cost that much to do the planning.
And as a young parent, many of us think, well, we're going to live forever. And unfortunately, that we certainly want that to happen. Our life expectancy is in the well into the 80s, but it's very important when you have children in particular that you lay out what your intention is and what your plans are and what you want for them so that your wishes are followed should something happen. Isn't that correct?
Over the years, I have come to learn through my clients' experiences that life is very, very fragile and we take it for granted, but the car accident or motorcycle accident or airline crash, those are all things that have happened to people that I know. And some have planned well, some have not planned well. And the differences are very evident in the amount of time that it takes to get their estates settled and to be sure that everyone is able to spend the appropriate emotional time mourning the loss as opposed to trying to grapple with property issues and who gets what. It can get very, very ugly. And even in the best of situations, it's just far messier, to use that word again.
Well, planning is 99% of the issue. And so we've talked a little bit about wills, and we've talked about the healthcare power of attorneys in my life. But then we went on, and I said, with as much as my husband and I were traveling, we said we need a general power of attorney. Discuss that a little bit for us, Dara.
Well, the general power of attorney is a interesting document. It shouldn't definitely be more than one page long. The stationery store has the one pager. The lawyer's office is going to be far more elaborate. But the general power of attorney is your signed statement before, in most states, a witness and a notary as required to give someone else the legal authority to act for you in a lot of different situations. We often refer to these as a financial power of attorney because your attorney, in fact, the fiduciary under the general power of attorney, can take that document to the bank and become a signer on, say, your checking account so that they can pay your bills. They can make other decisions about your property assets and other assets, your real estate and other assets. And the benefit of the general power of attorney is that if you are away out of the country, something like that, or if you become temporarily or permanently incapacitated, your attorney, in fact, can act for you, often without having to go through a very expensive court process.
So they're very important documents, but you also have to be very careful who you give them to.
Absolutely, because you are giving that person broad authority. Most states have as part of their laws, in fact, I would say all states have as part of their laws, that the general power of attorney is for the benefit of the person giving it. So if you, Sharon, gave me your power of attorney, the document is going to say that I can only act for your benefit, not for mine. I can only do things that you would do if you were acting. So I cannot override what I know of as your decisions about things. I have to carry out your values to the best extent possible.
So I know we're getting a little confusing here. We're talking about all these documents, but they're really relatively simple to sit down and go through all of them. So we've talked about the will. We've talked about a general power of attorney, health power of attorney. Let's talk a little bit about trust, because we hear about all kinds of revocable, non-revocable. Give us the two-minute education on trusts.
Well, a trust is a legal concept and document that can be used for a lot of different things. A trust is really a three-part relationship between you, the person who sets it up, someone who is the trustee of the trust, who manages the trust and carries out its terms, and then the trust beneficiaries, those people who literally benefit from the trust. So you can have a trust that's revocable, one that's irrevocable. You can have a trust that lasts for many, many years, or one that's very short term. We use the concept a lot in estate planning, but we also use it in real estate. In many states, the security interest that you have for the indebtedness on your home is referenced in the form of a deed of trust. So that's such a common phrase that I'm happy to have an opportunity to provide a little bit of education on the subject.
Well, thank you. And I think particularly there's so many various uses for trust. For instance, life insurance proceeds and trust for when I lost my dad 6 years ago. And so my mom, there's a living trust for her that she gets the benefit of all those assets, but he was able to pass a certain amount on his estate tax deduction. And then so it's a great estate planning tool.
It definitely is. If you have a trust as your primary estate planning instrument, then chances are your estate will not need to be subject to a probate court procedure at death. And in addition, if there is a long-term disability, most likely no one will need to ever go into court to be named as your conservator. So we often will put trust in place for people instead of wills as the primary document, so that if there's a spouse that is developing, say, an Alzheimer's situation, or if there's someone who is physically disabled, the trust is going to assure us that everyone can take care of that person without court intervention in most cases.
And I think also when you have children, it's the great planning tool for should something happen to you and you want to make sure that the property is maintained, the basic principle, and children can receive the income from that, right?
You certainly don't want to give large amounts of inheritance to children who are under age 18, which is the age of majority, because then there would need to be a conservatorship, a court process for them. And secondly, you probably don't want to give a lot of assets to young adults if you can help it. And using a trust that is built into either your will or as a subtrust to your revocable living trust, you can provide for your children, get their education paid for, get their care paid for, provide them with income, sort of be the financial parent for that child or young adult without having them have the burden of trying to figure out how to manage a large sum of money at the same time that they're trying to figure out how to manage their own lives and how to do so without you as their guiding parent. So the trust for children is just essential, and you can then choose what age or ages you want them to actually own their inheritance, but you've provided for their well-being all along.
It also is important, for instance, when you do have a family of substance, and we'll get to prenups in a minute, but let's say you have children that are going out and getting married, and yet you know they're going to stand to inherit a lot of money. By setting up a trust structure, you can actually protect that corpus should they eventually have a divorce. Is that correct?
Absolutely. You can, through spendthrift provisions in the document. There I go with the document again. Having the written document is so important. You can provide that the property isn't owned by the child. So if there's a divorce, the trust property does not get included in a property division. And in addition, if that child should be unfortunate enough to run up some bad credit card debts or incur other liabilities as they are learning and growing, the trust corpus is exempt from claims of their creditors because they don't own the trust funds. The trust owns the trust funds.
So this is really important, particularly for all the baby boomers out there that are, where a huge transfer of wealth is going to happen in the next few years. And this is a great planning tool for them to be able to preserve that principle for their generations to come in their family.
Absolutely. You can, in most states, have trusts that last for multiple generations. In addition, I will have clients come to me who are professionals who might incur professional liability due to the nature of their work, the doctors, lawyers, accountants, et cetera, that may get sued unintentionally. And they will ask me to help their parents set up spendthrift trusts for them so that if they did get sued, those trust funds from their parents would not be subject to those creditor claims. It is perfectly legal. There is nothing fraudulent about doing that because if it's never their money, then a creditor of theirs cannot put a claim on it.
It's always better to do that planning ahead of time before those lawsuits get filed, right?
Oh, yeah. First of all, you think a lot clearer, and secondly, you don't want to try to do something like that after the fact because there are fraudulent conveyance laws that would come into play.
So as a family out there, we've talked about the will, we've talked about the estate planning. I'd like to bring up what's happening in the tax laws right now because we've been in a roller coaster as it relates to estate laws, and neither you nor I can predict exactly what's going to happen in the next few years. So, but you can write into your documents certain elements that will provide flexibility based on changes in the tax laws. Is that correct?
Absolutely, and people need to be very aware of it. In 2009, we had a personal exemption from federal estate tax laws of $3.5 million. So far, there are no estate taxes owed by anyone who passes away this year in 2010. But January 1, 2011, we're back to having a $1 million exemption each. And even though we've had a serious reduction in values of assets in this country over the last couple of years, it's still fairly easy with a house and a pension plan and maybe an IRA and a life insurance policy to get real close to that $1 million mark. The will or one's trust can set up provisions that a surviving spouse will have a choice as to doing some what we call post-mortem estate planning, which means that if one spouse dies, the surviving spouse can still set aside the deceased spouse's exemption amount and therefore double what is available. And if we only have a $1 million exemption to work with, it will be very, very important to be sure that we can hang on to the $1 million exemption of the deceased spouse.
So this is exactly why, no matter who you are, if you have an estate plan and you have a will, you really need to look at it and update it based on what's happening in the estate area, because this is a great time for estate attorneys because people need to get themselves situated so that they can take the best advantage available under whatever the tax law is at that point in time.
Absolutely. And as I said earlier, these documents need to be reviewed fairly frequently, I say every 3 to 5 years. But at the same time, building in a lot of flexibility is very useful because we're all human and we all run at about 100 miles an hour. And it may be a little bit later. There may be law changes that take place unbeknownst to us. And so having flexibility built in is just essential.
So we've talked about the estate plan, the will, the change in the estate laws, but let's talk about the little more personal side of those of us that are getting up in the ages where we really need to have a living will. And anybody that's gone to a hospital for a procedure, the first question they ask is, do you have a living will? Explain a little bit about what a living will is.
A living will is a document that sometimes is referred to as a declaration, and but living will is the generic term. And in it, you choose how much, if any, life support or heroic measures you want to have used on you if you are in the dying process, an irreversible coma, or a permanent vegetative state. And every state has its own form of living will, which is another good reason to check with your local state if you have moved. Your old living will should be given legal effect, but you might want to use the document that people there in your new home are more familiar with. And it's a very, very personal decision, and it's something that each of us should do. It's not about foisting a decision on someone else, but rather taking responsibility for your own decision. I'm speaking very bluntly here, so that your family members don't have to try to figure out what you would want. Maybe you want every machine possible used to keep you going. Again, it's a personal decision, but many people do choose to say that they don't want to be hooked up to a machine with no advancing quality of life. Those are decisions you need to make, but guess what? You have to do it in writing.
And in being in my mid-50s, I have seen very often in the last few years friends of mine who didn't really understand what the wishes of their spouse was. And it's really heart-wrenching. So it's really important for you to establish what your desire is.
It is always going to be a very tense and emotional situation when someone is in the throes, so to speak. And so knowing what to do or having a piece of paper that says, here's what you do, can be very helpful, comforting. And then at the end of the day, you know that you've done what your loved one wanted as opposed to what you guessed.
Thank you, Dara. Now, we started the conversation talking about blended families. And when my husband and I got married, we didn't do a prenup because we had nothing to really talk about. So we were starting from zero together. But it's a really important document now, and it's, a lot of people hesitate when it's kids. They don't want to talk about a prenuptial agreement. That's when the use of trust may come in very, very handy. But let's talk about blended families getting together. Describe a little bit about what prenuptials are and the benefit that they bring.
Sharon, you've probably heard me say one of my favorite phrases before, and that is, love is love, but marriage is a contract. And in that contract, there are a lot of property issues and child issues that the law dictates what is going to happen unless the two parties who are about to join forces and share their lives together in a marriage contract, unless they define their own terms. So people often shy away from the prenuptial agreement and assume that it is something where they're going to give everything up, and that's just so not the case. In most states these days, both parties need to be fairly represented by an attorney. There needs to be plenty of time put into putting the agreement in place, and it truly needs to be an agreement, not a here, sign this, or I won't marry you sort of thing. Maybe there's not enough love there. I'm sorry, I'll get off that soapbox. Anyway, the prenuptial agreement can define a lot of things. It doesn't have to define everything, but it can define child care, who pays expenses. If there are blended families, that's certainly important. It can define what someone would end up with if the marriage doesn't work out and ends in a divorce or a legal separation. it is as it can be as wide as the ocean or very, very specific. But it's something that needs to be talked about. So if you and your soon-to-be spouse have already worked through several issues, we're going to live in my house and it's going to stay in my name, well, let's put that in writing. My children are going to live with us and they're going to have their own bedroom, but I'm going to be responsible for all of their expenses. Let's put that agreement in writing. You probably already have a lot of those agreements. We're not going to sign a joint tax return because I don't want to be responsible for any liabilities in your business. Let's put that in writing. And then you've got it all laid out, and some of those issues won't need to come up in the future for argument unless there's a need to change them. And prenuptial agreements can be changed as well.
And that's important for people to understand that as your marriage continues, you can go back and make revisions in your prenup and make it more applicable to your current situation.
Absolutely. And most states recognize the concept of a postnuptial agreement as well. So you're already married, but new issues have come up. You can contract with your spouse to either change the prenuptial agreement or to add on to the terms. And I also want to talk about non-marrieds and what they need to do, if I may jump in with that.
A very important issue, and I was going to ask you about it, so please go ahead.
People who are not married who share either their lives together or just their living quarters should also have written agreements in place. Now, this isn't necessarily about where you keep your peanut butter, but it is about things like who pays the rent, who pays the utilities, who pays the mortgage, who pays for the telephone, what kinds of things are we going to share together, are we going to buy things together, if so, how are we going to split them up. Just think about all of those things that people who are married have decisions to make about, and you as unmarrieds probably have many, many more. Many unmarrieds have children, so those issues need to be dealt with. You cannot correct my child, or yes, you should treat my child as your own and be sure that you discipline him. Those are just some minimal examples.
And it's very important because when you can sit down and discuss them with a lot less emotion, and it's really important to go ahead and get those documents in place so that you aren't in the middle of a trauma and trying to deal with it when your emotions are high.
That's very well put.
Tell me an example of someone who didn't do estate planning and left it to total chance.
Well, Sharon, I see a lot of that situation, unfortunately, and one that I'm involved in right now is a gentleman who was actually a retired attorney, if you can believe that. And while he was elderly, he died unexpectedly, literally the day before he had an appointment with an attorney to put a will in place. And unfortunately, his children had never gotten along very well with each other. And he left an estate. It wasn't a huge estate, but certainly there were assets in it that needed to be dealt with, some real estate, some bank accounts, and other investments. And we are now a year and 3 months past his date of death, and because of the argumentation going on between the two children, particularly one of them, we still don't have the estate settled, and at least 25% of the estate funds have been spent in attorney's fees over the argument. And if this gentleman had said, oh, well, I'll let the kids work it out, I think he would be horrified now to see that they were not enjoying life. They certainly were not enjoying each other. And we're not enjoying the largesse of what he was able to leave them.
And that's so important. We talk about blood and money and how sometimes it doesn't mix. And what the greed factor comes into play. And it's so very important for people to really delineate what it is they want to leave and how they want it distributed among their loved ones.
Definitely.
When we talk about the importance of the healthcare power of attorney and how we relate it to my life, it's really important, I think, to understand why it's required and why do hospitals ask for it. And how to, do you have a couple of examples related to healthcare power of attorney?
Definitely. Now, the healthcare power of attorney is your naming or appointing of someone else to make medical decisions for you. So you're taking your responsibility in your own hands and saying who you wish to be able to step into play. And I have two examples. One is a client who was stricken very suddenly with a stroke, and her significant other, to whom she was not married, did not have any legal authority to make medical decisions for her. In fact, he was barred from her hospital room. He was barred from the ER. He could only get minimal information about her because she had never taken the time to give him a healthcare power of attorney. Of course, she didn't expect to die of it turned out to be a brain aneurysm. But in those final hours of her life, it would have been very comforting to her friend to know that he could be there with her, and he was barred. And just because you are a spouse does not automatically give you the right to make decisions for your spouse. So even spouses need to have those documents between each other. Another example is that I had a client whose mother needed emergency medical care, and no one could find her healthcare power of attorney. And so they had to go through an emergency guardianship in court to have one of the children appointed as her guardian so that they could step in and make those decisions. And I know that those things are very expensive to do. What I was not fully cognizant of until my client told me was how emotionally wrenching it was to hear a court have to declare their mother incompetent in all the ways that that term has legal meaning before one of them could be appointed to make medical decisions for her.
How heart-wrenching. Plus the amount of time, if she needed emergency surgery, that I mean, you could actually lose a life if you don't have the appropriate documents in order.
Absolutely.
In talking about the needs for a will and estate planning, a lot of people say, well, I don't have anything, I don't need it. What's your response to that?
Well, my response is that everyone has more than they think will be at issue when they die. And I've had situations where people have died without wills, and they've had very small bank accounts, but by law, multiple people of the same level of claim, same level of blood relationship, who have been authorized or rather entitled to have a share of their estate. And so we've had to do a probate process where the attorney fees and the probate costs and so forth were far greater than anything in the estate, just to be able to enable those relatives to be able to handle the affairs, clean things up, get things out of the bank account, get things out of the safe deposit box even. So with a will, you can eliminate so much red tape, if you will, when you die. And so even if you have very, very little, it's so important to have the document in place.
Well, what we've talked about today are some maybe a little boring subject to some of you out there, but very important. Take a look at your family picture, whether it's your immediate family, your extended family, and look at those precious, precious beings that are part of your family. And think about, have you taken the steps that you need to protect your family and to protect your bank account? Next time you look at your bank account, look at that as well. It's so very important that we take those steps, and it doesn't take that long. And there are people like Dara out there that stand ready, willing, and able to support you and help you. And I'm going to go back to something that Dara said at the very beginning. Yes, there are a lot of self-help tools on the internet, But it's so important that you understand all of the elements that go into that planning. So we really recommend that you find an attorney that can help you. Now, we have some sample documents that Dara has provided that we're going to have provided on a link at itsyourturntothrive.com. But understand that those are to educate you, because if you can educate yourself before you go in to see your attorney, you'll save money because you'll have to spend less time with the attorney. And that's why Dara has shared these. But it's so important. Again, take a look at that picture. Do you need a trust for that child? Do you have a blended family and yet want all your children supported the same? Do you have in-laws that you want a protection from? Do you have in-laws that you want to make sure are taken care of in their elder years? So you want to talk to them about their estate planning. All of these elements are so important. And I know when my father passed and we sat down to reevaluate my mom's estate planning, it felt good when we left that my mom felt that she had been provided for. And my mom knew that the elements were put into place that prevented her from having to come up with it on her own. And that feeling is incredible. So have that feeling for yourself and for your family. Look at that picture and know I've provided for my family and I've provided for their well-being. Thank you so much, Dara.
Thank you, Sharon.
You have been listening to Sharon Lechter, the world's most passionate financial literacy advocate. To learn more about Sharon, visit www.itsyourturntothrive.com and see her exceptional content. To book Sharon for upcoming live events or coaching, call 480-607-1940.